Good morning.
Good morning.
And happy 4th of July weekend to everybody this morning. Good to have everyone here today. It's 4th of July weekend, so that must mean that Terri is with us. Just saying, those of you who have been members of the church for a long time know that Bob Wesley used to always be here on 4th of July weekend to sing. And Terry's been here, what, 5 years, more than that now? I forgot exactly how many years Terri's been with us, but we've been really excited to have her continue that tradition and welcome this morning. Good to have you here today. I'm going to be on vacation this coming week, and so the first few days of the week will be spent doing some moving. And then on Thursday, Sarah and I are going to go see Larry and Sandy Animal in Florida. So we will tell them hello from all of you and look forward to reconnecting with them. Next Sunday, Janice Lussmeyer, who is a commission ruling elder from Bartlesville, will be the guest preacher, so I hope you'll come and welcome Janice next Sunday. Also, because it's 4th of July weekend, the church office will be closed tomorrow, and then a reminder that we are on summer hours for Alberta, and so she's working an extra hour during the week that is taking Fridays off. And hopefully all of you have received the email link to our Church Connections survey that we're sending out in terms of doing our church mission study to get ready for future pastoral leadership needs. I think we get a weekly report of how many people have filled theirs out, and so I think about a dozen of you have done that so far. We want to get really strong participation in that. If you're not comfortable doing it via online computer, we can make out just some paper copies of that and hand those out, and you can pick those up from Alberta in the church office. We prefer you pick them up, fill them out, bring them back to the office, but if you prefer, she can give you a stamp envelope to mail it back in as well. So you've got the next few weeks to get that done, but hopefully you don't procrastinate and save it to the last minute, and if you can get that done this week, that will help us in our follow-up efforts to get that completed. And then 2 weeks from today, and the session has called a congregational meeting to discuss and vote on the possible sale of the manse, so that will be discussed at that meeting. And then some of you have probably heard by now, my email has decided to turn somersaults, and I can get my work email on my home computer, but I can't get my work email on my work computer for, you know, some strange technical reason that we haven't figured out. I can still get all my emails both at my home email address and my church email address, but it does take a little bit longer for me to respond just because of the situation that I'm in right now. And then let's see. Oh, and this being a communion Sunday, it's also a day where we receive the deacon's offering. The little green envelopes are for that, and so if you'd like to help the deacons in their mission work, they help out the FAST program and also the homeless shelter and Hannah's house, and do shut-in devotional literature. So if you would like to help them with that work, please use the green envelopes for that. Anyone else have any announcements that you need to make today? Yeah, Lyle. Okay. Susie? Oh, no, she's getting ready to be the liturgist here. So, any other announcements?
I'm sneaking.
But I ruined your sneaking, didn't I? Yeah. Any other announcements?
Please join me in our call to worship.
Given liberty beyond measure. Praise God.
Let us worship God. Please stand if you are able for our first hymn. It's number 331 in the hymnal, God of the Ages, Whose Almighty Hand.
walk with our heads held high, without noticing others and their burdens. We are even blinded to our own. We keep our mouths silent when we are full of stories to share about the good things that you have done for us. We even keep our actions silent as we become so overwhelmed with the needs of the world that we do nothing to overcome them. Fill us with your peace and with your mercy. Free us from the destruction of sin and restore us to a life lived in you.
Belong to the family of believers.
please know that you are always welcome to sing with me at any time and anywhere in my life. And this is on page 338.
God's word for us on this day. After this, the Lord appointed appoint 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If a man of peace is there, your peace will rest on him. If not, it will return to you. Stay in that house, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcome, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick who are there, and tell them, 'The kingdom of God is near you.' But when you enter a town and are not welcome, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town sticks to our feet, we wipe off against you.' Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God is near." The 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." He replied, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." May God bless you to our understanding this reading from God's holy word. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Have you ever noticed how much the idea of going on a mission trip has changed over the years? In today's Gospel lesson from Luke, we have the very first mission trip of the church. For those of you who thought Jesus only had 12 disciples who followed him around, think again. He had lots of followers, and this time he sends 72 of them out in teams of two, 36 teams, to serve as kind of an advanced group to go prepare the people for all the cities that Jesus was about to visit. Jesus tells these teams to travel light, to go where they are welcomed. Heal the sick, he says, and tell them that the kingdom of God is near. If people don't receive them, they are to shake the dust off their feet and move on. The results of that first mission trip were wonderful. In those days, illnesses were attributed to demons. So when the disciples returned and said, "Even the demons submitted to us in your name," what they meant was that they were successful in healing people. Jesus said, "That's great. That's really great what you've done. But there is better news than that. The better news is that God has fully accepted you. Your names are written in God's book." So that's what the very first mission trip was like. Now, fast forward about 2,000 years. In the church where I grew up, the first recollection that I have of mission trips were Presbyterian missionaries who were sent to some far-off, distant country to try to convert the people of that country to Christianity. And that's a model that's never really gone away. But my home church tried to expand the definition of mission trips just a little bit. I was in a large church with a large youth group, and every year, or every couple of years or so, we would send our youth group on a mission trip. Mission North one year, Mission West another year, really creative titles, but they would send the youth group out on different mission trips. But what they were trying to accomplish was something very different than that first century model. No longer was healing of the sick part of the mission model, because none of us really had the skills to do that. Preaching that the kingdom of God was near, well, we thought maybe having the name of the church painted on the side of the church van was good enough to do that job. Instead, members of the youth group served in soup kitchens, and maybe they would paint a house if that was needed, or perhaps they would be teachers at vacation Bible school. All of those are good things, but it's not exactly what the original 72 did. And to top it all off, the church made sure that it included fun tourist things to do on these mission trips to make sure that the youth would actually sign up to go. My more recent memories of mission trips have been two. One was 15 years or so ago, when we sent from our church a group to go to Hurricane Katrina relief efforts. And then more recently than that, when our most recent confirmation class walked across the street to pick up trash at the library. Again, not any healing of the sick was done. And if others asked, we would tell them, yeah, we were a church group that was doing this good deed in the community. But I don't think in either of those trips, either to help with Hurricane Katrina or to pick up trash, did I ever hear anyone say out loud, "The kingdom of God is near." Are we doing it wrong? Have we lost some of the key elements of what a mission trip is supposed to be all about? Well, yes and no. About 8 years ago, our presbytery hosted a speaker from our denomination, Vera White. And one of the topics of her little talk was this text that we just read out of Luke's Gospel. Vera told us that the harvest right now was plentiful. She said, if you took all of the people who say that they are unchurched in the United States, you would have the fifth largest country in the world. For those of us who like to claim the United States as a Christian country, think about that for a minute. If you took all of the unchurched in our country, you would have the fifth largest country in the world. Even among those that live closest to us, not those in some far-off, distant, pagan country, but those who live closest to us have lost the message those who are available for the harvest aren't sitting in the sanctuary, aren't sitting in the barn waiting to be harvested. You have to go out to do the harvest. You have to go out to where the people are. Yet we face some pretty obvious obstacles when it comes to that. If I were to ask for a show of hands this morning and say, okay, how many of you want to sign up to be part of a mission team? We're going to go out two by two, and we're going to canvass all the neighborhoods in our community, and we're going to tell them that the kingdom of God is near. How many of you would have your hands shoot right up? Yeah, not many, if any. Instead, we would all get together and grumble. Isn't that what the Mormons do? So, I could push for a model of doing mission that I know would never get off the ground. Or, maybe we could take a look at how mission has evolved and see that not everything is bad. For instance, we're pretty good at shaking the dust off of our feet if we're not received. We are not a particularly judgmental church. We leave the judgment to God. In that, we have not strayed very far from that original model for taking a mission. Also, the mission work that we do, we usually do it together. Take the flu shot day for just one example of how we are involved in mission in our congregation. And yes, there is a healing of the sick that takes place in that effort, or at the very least, prevention of them getting sick in the first place by having a flu shot. In that, we have not strayed very far from that original model of sending people out to take care of the sick. The hard part is the proclamation piece. You know, you could go out and say, God is near, the kingdom of God is near, but you know that in and of itself isn't going to do much, except raise some questions. If you go to someone and say the kingdom of God is near, they might answer back, how do you know that it's near? What do you mean when you say the kingdom of God is near? And if I accepted that news, what difference would it make in my life? So if you say the kingdom of God is near to someone, you just might start a conversation. Conversations. Pastor Susan Langhauser, I think, has figured it out. She said that she discovered that not too long ago, the number one fear of people in America has been replaced. It used to be that the number one fear of people in America was the fear of public speaking, which was even greater than the fear of dying. But that has now been replaced. The greatest fear of people now is the fear that you are stupid. And none of us wants that. We read in Scripture where it says, where God says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, my ways are not your ways, and we say, right. So why would I ever open my mouth to talk about the business of God? Why would I ever open my mouth to say something like, the kingdom of God is near? So we don't. We keep quiet. We don't say a word. We instead put lettering on the side of the church van saying what church we are from. We put a banner out on the holiday parade float and hope that people figure it out from there and come to our church. Except we've been trying that method for years, and we know by now it doesn't work. People don't flock to a church just because they see a sign somewhere. Langhauser invites us to live without the fear of abandoning ourselves to something beyond our control. That's where that fear of stupid thing comes. We want to maintain control. She says, abandon that control because this is something bigger than you are. When we start faith conversations, we're never going to have all the right answers. And that's okay. That doesn't mean don't start the conversation in the first place. It's simply an acknowledgement that we are planting some seeds that the God of the harvest will nurture and take from there. It doesn't all ride on us. We have an important part to play. Healing the sick. Proclaiming the gospel. But God takes our meager efforts and makes them grow into something beyond what we can imagine. We are given strength for that journey every time we gather here for worship and every time we gather for nourishment around the table. The kingdom of God is near. We receive nourishment from the Lord. And we all have a part to play in announcing that good news to others. Amen. Our hymn is number 295 in your hymnals. Go to the world. And again, all who are able, we invite you to stand.
Thank you.
cards back in the narthex for you to sign today. First one is a thank you card to our city commissioners for taking steps to clean up our city. The second one is a welcome card to, welcome the independence card to the Waters family, who recently purchased a new True Value hardware store out on West Main. And then also 11 thoughts and wishes and prayers to Reverend Brent Johnston. Mentioned last week, he is the pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Wichita, recently diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. I want to take a look at your prayer card this morning and ask if there are any updates on any of the folks listed on the prayer card or any additional people to add. So Sylvia Augustine had knee replacement and is in therapy for that. Any other updates? Okay, all of these folks we will remember during our communion prayers today. In Matthew's Gospel, Jesus said, "Freely you have received, freely give. Let us present God with the offerings of our lives and our members." Of the pardon you have in mercy given. We can bring only our thanks putting our trust in your Son, who alone saves us from evil. Therefore, in joy with apostles, prophets, martyrs, and saints in every time and place, we join in giving praise. God of glory, in thanks we remember how Jesus broke bread and gave the cup to make us partakers of his body and blood, so that he might live in us and we in him. God of mercy, in thanks we remember how Jesus invites us to his table, imprinting on our hearts his sacrifice on the cross. In gratitude we bow before the righteous one, declaring his resurrection and glory, and knowing that his prayers alone make us worthy to partake of his spiritual meal. Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that as we receive bread and wine, we may be assured that Christ's promise of these signs will be fulfilled. Eternal Father, lift our hearts and minds on high. Bear with Christ, your only Son, and with the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, now and forever. We pray today, especially for Sylvia, Melissa, Charlotte, Savannah, Michelle, Nikki and Rick, Jackie, Joan, Vicki, John, Melissa, Brent, Andy, Evelyn, the people of Ukraine, Art, Joan, Lucinda, and John, and for people of our church family, especially this morning, for John, and for John and Jeff. All of this we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread and blessed it and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, as I minister in his name now and give it to you, saying, This is my body broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. This is the body of Christ given for you. In the same way, Jesus took the cup, and after he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins.